So let's get started with the organization of memory. So memory is kind of the mind of the computer where it remembers the information, the data in our program. So the certain states of the variables and so forth. So it contains the bytes of binary data because memory is only binary, 0 and 1s. You can think of it being organized as an array of bytes starting at position 0 up to a very large offset, and this offset kind of represents the address that you want to access, read or write and modify the kind of the data. So this is logically how you think about it, but in fact the operating system provides us with pages of memory. And where are these logically pages coming from? Well, they come from the physical memory, so our DIMMs, for example, that we bought and we stick in to our PC, right? Your computer maybe has 8 or 16 gigabyte main memory, and this is the memory pages, partitioned into memory pages. And so typically in a granularity of, for example, 4 kilobytes of data, the operating systems hands them over to the applications. So then we have this address space, and this address space is basically 64-bit on our 64-bit machines. That also is the difference to a 32-bit machine, where you can address only like 4 gigabyte of main memory with a couple of tricks. With 64-bit memory, basically you have an unlimited amount of physical memory that can be addressed. So talking about physical memory, each application in fact receives an own so-called virtual address space, as you will see in operating systems. And the operating systems now maps these physical pages that it has provided by the hardware, our memory DIMMs, into this virtual space. And the processor supports this translation between virtual and physical addresses using the memory management unit, or MMU in short. So why do we need memory by the applications? Well, we know that data and code, they are both stored in memory in our von Neumann architecture, and both need to be managed by operating systems such that you can run multiple applications at the same time. So what happens now when you execute an application in a simplified fashion? Well, the operating system first of all has to reserve some physical memory for you. Now these instructions get loaded into the memory, and this is what we will later call the text segment. And this text segment, where you load the code, is typically read-only to prevent that people manipulate the data and kind of change the way your application behaves, which is a security problem. So hackers in the past, they modified the code of your application if they could to make it do some kind of malicious activities. Okay, now then we blend in libraries in a read-only fashion in this virtual address space as well. And that means we can share the libraries between different processes that all use the same libraries. Good. Now comes the core, what we talked today about, which is the stack. So the stack is memory that is reserved for local variables and function calls. It is limited in terms of its size, and we will see how it is managed. Once all this memory is reserved, you have the libraries blended in and the code loaded, the main and the stack prepared, the main function is basically invoked. So here we now see a mapping between the physical address space and the virtual address space. So let's get started with the physical address space. So you could imagine your machine has 8 gigabyte of main memory or something, which is kind of now this physical address space starting from address 0 to some offset. Now we have here, for example, some pages, like the red ones, they do not belong to this particular process or application that is shown on the left side, but it could be another application, okay? We can run many applications at the same time, and the operating system gives us those pages. So now we have, from one application perspective, we have a virtual address space that starts at some offset 0, and then you can have some holes, which is here the gray area, and then you have some kind of information stored in different segments. Here we have a text segment, which is kind of our, for example, code. And this code data somehow must live somewhere. So what you need to do is you need to map the pages of this virtual address space somehow to the physical address space over here, and then the data is actually stored in those different pages here. We also see that data at this offset basically here, this page, is stored down here. Not a problem, that's all handled by the memory management unit. Then we have a so-called data segment, which we talk about later. We have the stack, which contains our local variables and our functions that we are executing. So let's talk now about the stack. So the stack is basically an abstract data type, which we'll talk later, part of the lecture series. Most importantly, it has two operations that you can do on a stack. You can push data on top of it, and you can pop, which removes the last added item. You can think of it as a stack of paper, yeah, and you can take a new paper, add it on top of this stack of paper, but when you remove it, you're not removing in between of this paper stack or the bottom, you always remove from the top, okay? So that's basically the stack. You put something on top or you remove it from the top. So two operations, pushing or popping, removes the item. So it follows there with a last in, first out policy. So that means the last item you put in it, it gets out first. So the stack is really used to manage function calls and provide the storage for them. Every time you call a function, you push information about this function to the stack. And every time a function ends, you pop the information from the stack, returning to the previous function. So today's lecture is also a bit involved, I would say. So I will spend a lot of time repeating some of these core concepts in order to make you really understand this principle. So let's have a look. Let's imagine we have a function, our main function, that calls worker 1 and then worker 4. So this is a function called worker 1 and this is a function worker 4, right? Later in the program you may call for main worker 2 and worker 3, for instance, right? Can happen, you can call as many functions as you like, as you know. But let's have a look what happens in this first step. So the main function gets started after we have allocated our memory and initialized it. Now we push in, we invoke basically a worker 1 function. So we push onto the stack information about worker 1. Worker 1 calls in turn worker 4, so we push worker 4 information. At some point this worker 4 function is completed, so we pop, removing this information from it. That means it remains worker 1 in main. And then worker 1 completes and we basically pop worker 1 from the stack.